If you have a Bible, turn with me to 1 Thessalonians and chapter 4. We're going to read verses 13 through 18, then I will pray, and then we will dive into those verses and seek to understand them. 1 Thessalonians 4, starting in verse 13, and this is what the Apostle Paul writes. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Let's pray. Father, as we come to study the scriptures this morning, we're thankful we have them. I pray that as I teach, you might give me simplicity, use of language that would be easy to understand. And as we all listen, that you might give us hearts that don't just discard what you have to say, but actually take it in, consider it, and might even believe it. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. In his book, Man's Search for Meaning, Holocaust survival Viktor Frankl tells a poignant story about how important hope is for human life. He recounts the tale of a man that he calls F, who was with him in the concentration camp. And this particular man had a dream that on March 30th, 1945, the camp would be liberated and his suffering would end. This particular dream infused this man with hope as he endured unimaginable sufferings. But as that date, March 30th, 1945, drew nearer, they began to hear news that perhaps the liberation wasn't coming as soon as they thought it was, and that the suffering wouldn't end. And the man began to decline. On the 29th, he got sick. On the 30th, he fell unconscious. On the 31st, he died. Frankl notes this: to all outward appearances, he had died of typhus. But the ultimate cause of my friend's death was that the expected liberation did not come, and he was severely disappointed. His faith in the future and his will to live had become paralyzed, and his body fell victim to illness. Now, on a far more trivial level, aren't you and I also familiar with how important hope is to flourishing in human life? I mean, just think about it. When we're struggling, what do? We look to the future with hope that the suffering we're currently enduring will end. So when we're busy at work and trying to work on this huge project, or at school, and all of our routines of life are thrown out of the way, what gets us through? Well, the hope that we're going to finish and that we can pick up our healthy routines. When we're sick, what gets us through? Well, the hope that one day we'll be well again. When we're in the middle of a pandemic, what gets us through? Well, the thought that one day things will go back to normal. But what happens when our hope is deferred? What happens when we're sick and no matter how many treatments we get or no matter how many specialists we see, we continue to struggle with our illness? What happens inside? Well, darkness plunges in. Or what happens in this pandemic when the finish line just always seems out of reach and we have to live another day and, you know, in Bill Murray's Groundhog Day? What happens? Your soul descends into darkness. You can feel the life leaving your soul. I was reading an article from the New York Times this week that was talking about the experience of living in a prolonged pandemic, and it used the word languishing, which it describes as this: stagnation and emptiness, which feels as if you're muddling through your days, looking at your life through a foggy windshield. Perhaps you can identify with that. And I want to suggest to you that it's actually connected to a lack of hope. When we come to our text this morning, verses 13 through 18 here of 1 Thessalonians 4, the people to whom Paul was writing were also struggling. I don't know if they would use the word languishing, but they were facing something that had attacked their hope in life. They were struggling with bereavement. They had lost loved ones, fellow believers who they used to go to church with, go to small group with, go to class with. They had died, and this had attacked their hope. Nothing, perhaps, confronts our sense of hope like death does. All of us are familiar with this. So Paul writes to them, and he writes to them to rekindle their hope, so to speak, by pointing them to Jesus. And I hope that as we read his words to them, that our hope might be rekindled as well. We're going to think about this passage just under three headings: hope challenged, hope rekindled, and hope spread. First, hope challenged. The story of the beginning of the Thessalonian church is told in Acts chapter 17. There was a city, Thessalonica. Paul went to visit it on his second missionary journey. He was only there for a matter of weeks, but when he was there, he told them about Jesus, the reality that Jesus had come to save them from their sins so that they could have a reunited relationship with God. A few of them believed, and the church was born. As soon as they believed, persecution hit, and Paul was actually kicked out of the city in a matter of weeks, maybe 3 weeks, maybe 6 weeks. Yet the Thessalonians who had believed, as we see in chapter 1 of this letter, were radically transformed. They used to worship other gods, but all of a sudden they worshiped the Lord Jesus Christ. They all of a sudden found that they loved other people, and they had this hope for the future. They too faced persecution right off the bat for their Christian faith. Yet Paul could say of them in chapter 1, verse 10, that they were waiting for Jesus to return. They were waiting with hope. However, something had happened between the time Paul had been with them and when he wrote this first letter. It was probably only a matter of months. And as we mentioned before, what had happened was that some of those believers who had trusted in Christ along with them had passed away. And as we can see from our text, this had rocked them to the core. At the very least, they were discouraged. As Paul says in verse 18, they needed to be encouraged. But it was probably worse than that, as he suggests in verse 13, that they had descended into a hopeless grief. Now, we don't know why exactly these believers were struggling so bad with the death of their loved ones. Perhaps it's because they thought that death meant that their believing loved ones wouldn't get to experience the glories of God's new creation. But even though we don't know why exactly they're struggling, I think you and I can identify with the emotional experience of struggling with bereavement. Because you and I have all lost loved ones. We have felt the sting of death. We have spent our lives trying to build relationships with one particular person, only to have that person ripped away from us in death. And we felt the subsequent loss in all of the firsts that occur after their death. The first time that there's a meal and there's that chair empty. The first time that we go and we have to sleep in our bed alone. The first time that we have a thought and we want to pick up the phone and call that particular person only to realize that they're not actually there. And of course, it's not just that we're separated, but the separation feels so permanent, doesn't it? We've all looked on the dead bodies of our loved ones as they're there in the nursing home, as they're there in the hospital, and thought to ourselves, this is it. There are going to be no more hugs. There are going to be no more stories. He's not going to tell me any more of his signature jokes. We've all stood in cemeteries as they lower the casket into the ground or the urn, and they dump the dirt on it, and we just sit there in the coldness and in the darkness of that moment, and we say, it sure feels like the end. And of course, we start to grieve. Now, it's important for me to underscore this morning that there's nothing inherently wrong with grief. You know, some Christians have this view of the world that because of Jesus, you can't grieve, you can't have sadness, you're always supposed to be walking on the clouds, it's all rainbows and butterflies, but nothing could be further from the truth. Paul's not writing here to say it's inappropriate to grieve. He's trying to infuse their grief with hope, but for the moment, let's just focus on the appropriateness of grief. Because as has been said from this pulpit before, death is not natural. We were designed to live forever. To live forever with God and those that we love, but something terribly wrong happened. Sin entered into the world and it broke everything. That's why it feels so wrong when our loved ones die and pass away from our existence. So it's right for us, because sin and death represent something broken in the world. It's right for us to mourn when someone dies. And as if that weren't enough evidence, just think of the Lord Jesus, who did all things perfectly. When he encountered death, what did he do? Well, John 11 tells us he does two things. He weeps because of the sadness of what has just happened. Now think of this. Jesus in the story is about to raise the dead man from life, but yet he weeps because the sadness of it and watching his friends cry over the loss of their loved ones hits him at the core of who he is. Not only does he weep, but he also rages. John 11, the word that is used there is he's deeply moved, but that word actually is the same picture that is used of a horse's nostrils flaring when the horse is mad. Okay, have you ever seen that? Maybe you've seen an animal get, a horse get mad, its nostrils flare. That's what Jesus was doing in John 11. Why? Because he knew that sin and death had spoiled his Father's good world and that his loved creation had to deal with the ramifications of it as they walked the earth. So he was sad and he was angry. And if Jesus lived perfectly and that was his reaction to death, then of course for us, we can weep and we can be angry as well. But for the Thessalonians, and sometimes for us, our experience of grief actually goes further than this. We descend into this darkness that swallows us up completely. There are no rays of light. There is no hope at all. As Paul writes here, we begin to grieve as those who have no hope. In Thessalonica, as one pastor has noted, there was an inscription that was found in the city that might shed light on what Paul means by this. And here's what the inscription reads. After death, no reviving. After the grave, no meeting again. Many non-believers at the time when Paul wrote this believed that death was final, that it was the end, that the goodbyes of this world were the final goodbyes, the final time that you would ever interact with those who have died. And of course, many in our culture believe that too. We exist, and when we die, we go into nothingness. And with such a belief, it's no wonder that the death of our loved ones can bring about such a deep darkness. So death, it presents this challenge to hope. And Paul, aware of this, writes to the Thessalonians to, our second word, rekindle their hope. I want you to notice right away, even as he starts here in verse 13, that he doesn't deal with them harshly. He doesn't reprimand them. He doesn't say, hey, you're a Christian, you shouldn't be grieving. He doesn't add guilt to their grief, which we so often do to ourselves. We feel bad that we feel bad about death. No, he doesn't do that. He actually writes to them gently. He calls them brothers and sisters, and he tries to encourage them by lifting their eyes from the graves of their loved ones to the Lord Jesus Christ. And to do so, he reminds them of one thing in the past and one thing in the future. The first thing he reminds them of, this is verse 14, is the death and resurrection of Jesus. He said, I want to inform you of something. I want to remind you of something. I want to remind you of the death and resurrection of Jesus. Now, what's interesting to me about this passage is that the people to whom he was writing already knew about the resurrection of Jesus, right? He's writing to Christians. Part of what Christians believe is the death and resurrection of Jesus. So he's informing them, so to speak, of something they already know. But however, as we realize, it's distinctly possible for us to know something intellectually and for that to have no functional bearing on our lives, right? We all know that we're supposed to eat healthy, we're supposed to get enough sleep, and we're supposed to exercise, right? But no matter how many studies you read on that in the newspaper or in your favorite magazine, no matter how much evidence is put there in front of you, it doesn't often change us, does it? I mean, we still go to Chick-fil-A way too much. We still lay in our beds scrolling through our phones, and we never use the gym memberships we own, not to speak personally or anything like that. But it can be the same way with the death and resurrection of Jesus, can't it? We think to ourselves, yeah, that happened, but so what? Well, Paul is addressing the so what here. What he's doing is he's saying he's drawing this straight line between what happened to Jesus and what will happen to our believing loved ones who have died. Look at what he says there in verse 14. Just as Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep or those who have died. You see, when Jesus rose again, it wasn't just some sort of magic trick to prove that Jesus was who he said he was. It wasn't just a one-time thing for one person. No, as John Stott says, Jesus' resurrection was a pledge and a pattern of his people's resurrection. A pledge That united with Jesus Christ, the same exact thing that happened to Jesus would happen to every single believer. He died, they died. He rose again to a new and wonderful life, they will rise to a new and wonderful life. It's a pledge, but it's also a pattern. It shows us exactly what that future resurrection will look like. Elsewhere in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul speaks of Christ's resurrection as the first fruits. That's language taken from agriculture. So we plant seeds, and when those seeds come to harvest, the first plant that comes to maturity and produces fruit, that is called the first fruit. Think of your tomato garden, right? So you go, you plant your seeds, hopefully, mine don't always do this, hopefully the tomato plant grows, and that first tomato that comes, that bright, red, juicy tomato that comes, what does that mean? Well, does it mean that you should be thankful for the one tomato and sort of shut down the garden? No. It means that you should clear out your counter, because what happened to that first tomato is about to happen to all the tomatoes, and you're about to have a whole lot of tomatoes in your kitchen and not know what to do with them, right? That's what Paul's saying here about Christians, about people who trust in Christ. Jesus was the first fruits. He's the first tomato, but anybody who trusts in him by virtue of their union with him, the exact same thing that happened to him is going to happen to our believing loved ones. They're dead now. But one day, they will rise to new life. Do you see how this, just this piece of Paul's argument infuses our despair with just one ray of hope? You know, we said earlier that the death of our believing loved ones seems so permanent. It seems like they're gone forever. But it's not so. Paul says here that they are merely sleeping, that they are awaiting the time when Jesus returns to give them new life. In fact, do you know what the word cemetery means? It actually means a sleeping place. Or as John Stott says, he describes it as a dormitory of the dead. So when you go to visit the graves of your believing loved ones, and you're tempted to think, this is it. This is where they will be forever. That's not true, brothers and sisters. They're only resting. They're only taking a nap. And one day, as surely as Jesus died and rose again, as concrete as that was, so your believing loved ones will rise in the same way. And doesn't that make you want to cry out what Paul says again in 1 Corinthians 15? Where, O death, is your victory? But there's actually more than this. As if it weren't enough to point them backwards and encourage them that way, Paul also points them forwards and encourages them in a different way. This is verse 15, where Paul writes that he has a word from the Lord. Now, whether that's a special apostolic vision or that's just something that was passed down over time from Jesus to Paul, we don't know. But we know the content of what he received, and it has to do with what is specifically going to happen when Jesus returns. Now, when we broach the topic of the return of Christ, it's really, really easy to get sidetracked into discussions about dates and seasons and signs and symbols and all these particular views of the end times. It essentially becomes fodder for Christian speculation and frankly, Christian argument. But we have to remember that when Paul brings up the end times here, he's not doing it so that we can have these theoretical arguments about what's going to happen. No, he writes it for a very specific purpose so that he can encourage the Thessalonians in the face of death. So we have to remember that when we study this. And he writes in verse 15, when Jesus comes back, a few things are going to happen. First, his return is going to come in a very public way. It's going to be accompanied by trumpets, the voice of the archangel, the cry of command. No one's going to be able to miss it. And then when he comes back, what's going to happen is that those who have died trusting in Christ are going to be raised. They are going to experience the resurrection that we've just talked about. They're going to go join Jesus in the air. And after that, those who are still living when he returns, trusting in Christ, will also rise to meet the dead in Christ and Christ in the air. And the point of that is there in verse 17, that we will be together with them and always with the Lord. So the dead in Christ and the living in Christ will be together with him when he returns. Now, Paul writes all of this to tell the Thessalonians that there will be no disadvantage for those who have already died before the return of Christ. Remember that some of them thought that because they had died before Jesus returned, that maybe they wouldn't get to experience the wonders of God's kingdom. But Paul says nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, those who have died before Jesus' return trusting in him will actually have a place of preeminence. They're going to be the first to experience the resurrection and to meet him in the air. So dying ahead of his return is not a disadvantage, but one could actually say it's an advantage. This, of course, was Paul's view of death. Some of you are studying Philippians, and you remember Philippians 1, where he writes that to live is Christ and to die is gain, and that his desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. So when a believer dies, his or her soul goes to be with Jesus in that instant. But then when Jesus returns, his or her body will be the first to be raised with him. So there's no disadvantage to dying before Jesus returns. And further, this passage emphasizes that the poignant separation that we talked about earlier that we feel when our loved ones die, well, that's not going to be permanent either. You see, the dead in Christ and the living in Christ will both be raised so that, verse 17, they might be together with him. You know, from time to time, I've heard people criticize Christians for looking forward to the reunion with their dead loved ones who have trusted in Christ. You know, it normally has a pretty spiritual tone to it. People say, well, you should be looking forward to Jesus and not the reunion with your dead loved ones. And of course, that's partially right. You know, the primary relationship that Christians will enjoy in heaven is a renewed relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and God himself. But let's not downplay the fact that part of the glory of Jesus' return is that the believing relationships that we have now will actually continue into eternity. Do you remember what God told Adam in the garden in the original creation? You remember what he said? He said, even though he had God, he had this perfect relationship with God, what did God say to him? He said, it's not good that you're alone. And so it will be in the new creation. The glory of the new creation is, yes, we get to enjoy our new renewed relationship with God, but we also get to enjoy renewed relationships with all those who have been swept away from us here in life. You know, I wonder, do you have a group of friends that you don't see them very often, but whenever you do see them, you can say something like, it was like we were able to pick up and nothing had happened. Do you have friends like that? Well, I think that's actually a dim hint of what Paul is saying here. The reality is that all of us are going to be separated from spouses, from friends, from mentors, from family members by death. And it will be devastating. But because of the resurrection of Jesus, when he comes back, what it means is that we are going to be able to pick up those relationships as though we had never been apart. And we're going to bless God for it. And we're going to say, thank you. You're the one who made this relationship a reality because both of us have trusted in Christ, and we bless you that we can continue this relationship for eternity. And again, doesn't that thrill our hearts? Remember what the pagan inscription said? After death, no reviving. After the grave, no meaning again. The Bible says this, for those who have trusted Christ, after death, a sure reviving. After the grave, you will meet again. So yes, we mourn, we cry, we weep over the death of our loved ones who are in Christ. But we also smile because we know that one day when Jesus returns, we will experience precisely what he has experienced together. We have died like him. We will be raised to new life and continue our relationship with him and with all the believers that we have spent our time on earth building links with. We mourn, but we mourn with hope. Well, that brings us to our third point, and we'll be brief with this, and it's simply this, hope spread. Okay, so hope is challenged by death. Hope is rekindled by looking at Jesus. And now what are we supposed to do with that hope that Paul has just shared with us? Well, that's verse 18. Paul writes this, we are supposed to encourage one another with these words. Thessalonians weren't just supposed to receive these words from Paul, but they were essentially supposed to pass them on to fellow believers. Interesting part about this verse to me is who Paul asked to do the encouraging. Notice that he doesn't ask the pastors or he doesn't ask the elders to do the encouraging. He actually asks the congregation to do the encouraging. You know, from time to time, we'll get these phone calls or emails at the office and they'll say, you know, something, whoops, Something has happened to so-and-so. So can you, as the pastor, call them or visit them or send them something to encourage them? And I get that to some extent. And there are certain times when, a pastoral touch or perspective is needed. But if you look at these verses, Paul's actually moving in the opposite direction. Okay, he's saying, I'm not giving a particular pastoral task for pastors. I'm actually giving a congregational task for the congregation. That the believers in the congregation are supposed to take these words that he has just shared with them and actually talk to each other about them. The believers, the brothers and sisters in the congregation are supposed to be the ones who are sending notes to each other or texts to one another or praying with one another or inviting each other out to coffee just so they can talk about the resurrection when they become aware of the fact that one of their members is struggling. John Stott comments on this. He says that Paul's use of one another emphasizes the reciprocity of Christian care. We're not to leave it to an elite of professional counselors or comforters. They have an important role to fulfill, of course, but supporting, caring, encouraging, and comforting are ministries which belong to all the members of the body of Christ. The basic message is don't outsource encouragement. Don't professionalize it, but do it yourself. You know, at a place like Parkside, as big as this place is, this is actually the only way this works, okay? Because before the pandemic, I don't know what the numbers are now, we had like 3,000 people coming here on a Sunday morning, right? And there are 10, maybe 11 pastors. If you do the math, that's one pastor for every 300 people, okay? I can hardly know 300 people's names, let alone the intimacies of what is going on in all of your lives. So it's really hard for me to know when I should encourage you or how to encourage you. But the reality is that you know exactly what's going on in the lives of the people in this congregation. You know when somebody in your small group is struggling and that a card would be appropriate. You know when somebody in your men's group or your women's group or your Sunday morning group is grieving and it would be a good time to pray for them and encourage them. It's actually a gentle reminder to get involved because that's how you experience the fullness of Christian community. And as a pastor, let me tell you this. It's one of the most encouraging things in the world when I see you doing this, when I see you living out, encouraging one another and not waiting for the quote unquote professional to do it. So if you are doing this, let me just encourage you, keep it up, keep doing it. We need your encouragement. And if you're not, take a step this week. Think to yourself, who needs a word of encouragement and how can I actually meet them? Well, there we have it. Hope challenged, hope rekindled, and hope spread. Just one final thought as we close. Whenever we talk about death, it's inevitable that thoughts of our own mortality come to mind. We may be talking about the death of loved ones, but as we talk about their death, it actually brings to our mind our own future death. And we don't often talk about death in our culture. We don't even like to think about it. We sort of keep it at arm's length. But I want to suggest to you this morning that death is actually a phenomenal opportunity, as you think about it, to ask the hard and the important questions of life. Questions like this. Do I actually have any hope, not only for life in a pandemic, but hope for death? Do I actually, when people come to my funeral, will there be mourning with hope because of my faith in Christ, or will there just be mourning? Because you see, the Bible's really clear that all of the benefits that we have just talked about, death and resurrection and the return of Christ to be with him, those are only for those who trust in Christ in this life. Those who don't, they will also be raised at the last day, but they won't be raised to life. They'll be raised, as the Bible says, to destruction and to eternal separation from God. So death then presents us with an opportunity to settle these matters in our own hearts. Thinking about death can be the pathway actually to life. It's my wife's story. A friend of hers died in a car accident in high school. She wasn't a believer at the time, she was an atheist. But as a result of that friend dying, she started asking questions. She asked one of her other friends, she said, "How do I know that Christy is okay, the girl who died?" Her other friend happened to be a Christian and said, "Well, you can know that Christy is okay because she trusted in Jesus and all these things that we've just talked about are true." And that set my wife on a journey. She read a whole bunch of religious books, a whole bunch of religious teachings, which eventually brought her to the point where she realized that the Bible spoke differently than any other religious book in the world, and that Christianity believed something different than all the religions of the world, and she eventually trusted Christ. That might be you here this morning. Perhaps somebody in your life has died, and it's forced questions of death upon you. Perhaps even as we talk, thoughts of death have come into your mind. Now, the easy thing is to stiff arm them and say, hey, I don't want to think about that. But let me say, don't do that. Don't actually rest until you have an answer for death. Don't actually rest until you have a plan for death. You might want to explore all the religions of the world. You might be like my wife and need to do that. But let me suggest this just as we close. There's one difference between Christianity and all the other religions of the world. And the one difference is that the founder of our particular religion is alive, right? All of the philosophy, for as good as it might be, of all the other religions of the world, you can go and you can find the grave of the founder. Their teaching was not sufficient to save them from death. But our founder, you can't go to a grave. You can't find his body. He's actually alive. He's actually living. And he says, I've beaten death. I've already handled it. Hundreds of people saw this when I came back from the dead. And you can beat it too if you trust in me to forgive your sins. So who are you going to go with? A philosophy that has some nice thoughts but can't deliver the founder from death? Or are you going to go with the one that has already been proven to be able to beat death, to have the power to resurrect? Let's pray. Oh, Father, we thank you that that's true. That we don't commemorate Jesus, that we don't come and remember him, that he's not dead, that he's not in a grave somewhere that we can go visit and memorialize, but that he's alive, that he lives and reigns with you and he's coming back and he's one day going to bring us to be with him. So Lord, if there are people here today who don't believe, may they believe or at least pursue who this Jesus is. And for those of us who come with heavy hearts, God, would you encourage us with the truth that what happened to Jesus is going to happen to us. And what happened to our believing loved ones in their death, and if they trusted Christ, they too will live with him. Please encourage our hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.